Misha to play
Misha
John Wilkes? No, I think did Misha play John Wilkes Booth, is that right? Okay, so Misha shot him, and then we carried Billy off stage, and the response was, I think the phrase, underwhelming, doesn't do justice.
Crickets.
We appreciated it.
You can literally hear paint drying, building away.
Building away.
What was Dr. Ben's comment?
Dr. Ben was, we came off to literally awful, nobody cared. It's like they didn't care that something terrible happened to the president. And we
I cared. Say,
and Dr. Ben goes, too soon? Dr. Ben's joke was the best joke of the whole bit, and only five of us heard it. But, anywho.
Nevertheless.
Like the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, we almost lost Billy Moran. So thank you. We dodged a huge bullet, and we're so lucky. The rest of the con is dedicated to Billy Moran, and we still got him. He's still with us. Woo, precious cargo. In fact, I say we call it a day. Thanks, everybody. Have a great weekend. Do what I'm supposed to do. Ladies and gentlemen, you know him, you love him.
All day because last night I took a photo of myself grabbing Rich's ass
and deleted it.
And so we're trying to work through it.
And that was you stalked that and grabbed that hiney without giving me the heads up. I tell you, I was leaning forward to fix the radio, being a good Samaritan.
He was fixing that radio for so fucking long. And it would have been rude not to grab your ass.
How do you really fix the radio?
I was thinking, you know what, this is the same thing that
you
did.
Yeah, by the way, this is how he fixes the radio. I'll just show you. This is how he fixes the radio. That's it. That's him. I was just remembering. As I was walking up, somebody backstage was like, and remember, this is being live streamed, so. Just as I was doing that, I was like, oh, right. Shit.
Yeah. I was actually thinking there's going to be pictures all over the internet of you shaking your butt and me going.
I just want to say the radio got fixed, okay? It doesn't matter how I did it. Secondly, this is exactly what happened when you guys stole my phone and took unsavory pictures of yourself. I find myself in the position of apologizing.
Well, as you should.
For fixing the radio.
Yeah.
I can't help it that I have a magnetic bottom. And your hand was attracted to it, drawn to it, if you will.
Not cool.
A danger
bottom? Not cool. My bottom apologizes. Ladies and gentlemen, Misha Collins.
Hi, everybody. I do want to apologize for having posted that photo.
No.
It's tasteless.
It's okay, we've met you.
So sorry. So, speaking of ass grabbing, I actually don't know where I was going with that. It opened up a panoply of different options for me. I think I'll go in this direction. So, my college roommate, Eric Marshall, is here today. He's right there, he's standing up, he's waving. Yep. And we haven't seen each other in a while, and we had five people that were living, so at the University of Chicago, where we went to school, you had to stay in the dorm the first year, but then after the first year, you could go rent an apartment somewhere. So five of us rented an apartment, and it was furnished. One of the kids that lived there with us, his uncle owned a motel, and the motel was like a flea bag motel. And the flea bag motel, it was like, this is too gross. We have to upgrade our furniture.
So you naturally took it for free.
Well, free furniture. So they were like, what do you want? And we were like, well, we want as much as we can fit in the U-Haul. So we got six extra mattresses.
Oh, God.
Along with these, like vomit-stained, upholstered chairs and really uncomfortable.
So
and these mattresses, I mean, they were basically medical waste. But that, anyway, we furnished our whole place with these amazing free furniture. And we had this pile of mattresses that were, you know, riddled with bed bugs. And were, like, absolutely blinding under a black light. That's disgusting, if you understand the reference. So, we would invite people over to play King of the Mattress Pile. It was a game we invented that we loved, which was just this wobbly pile of mattress, like rancid mattresses in the middle of the living room, and we would just wrestle each other, and whoever got thrown off the mattress lost. And we spent a lot of time at a very, I would say, you know, academically esteemed university playing King of the rancid mattress pile.
Hey, who can get herpes
we
today?
Did other, I'm going to just tell a few college stories because Eric is, you know, inspired me to do that. One that I just remembered, Eric, I had gone to the store. I was a vegan at the time, and so that meant that I ate as much food as I possibly could all the time because I was never satisfied. And a friend from college recently, Jen Moran, recently told me, hey, I just wanted to tell you, I remember watching you eat in college and being revolted. I actually thought that she was gonna go, like, I was watching you eat and I was like, you know, turned on or something, and that's not the direction she went. She said, revolted. So I had bought all these very large yams. They were like this long. They were enormous. And I had 10 of them. And so, do you remember this? Yeah.
He's scarred for life.
And so I baked them. And then I was like, well, that's a lot of yams. I might as well make lemon out of this lemonade out of these lemons. So I, or yams. And so I said to my roommates, hey, if you guys each, I'll bet you each $10. So they put in, you know, $10 a piece, and I put in, you know, against that 50, that I could eat all 10 yams in 10 minutes. 10 minutes is a yam a minute. And so we started a timer. They weren't hot, so that wasn't the challenge. The challenge was that they were actually, the aggregate volume of these yams was more than my stomach. So I started eating, and it was like, I got through one yam in 2 minutes. And I was like, all right, I gotta pick it up. And I got through two yams, and it was like 6 minutes. And I got halfway through the third yam, and I started going, like, gagging as I was trying to swallow. And there was just no way I was gonna get through. But I was already, like, absolutely stuffed with yam. And now, not only was I, like, on the verge of throwing up, but I lost $50. And I wandered into the pantry and I saw a bottle of apple cider vinegar.
Oh no.
And it was like a pint-sized bottle of apple cider vinegar. And I brought it out and I said, guys, double or nothing that I can drink this in 10 minutes. And they all saw an opportunity and so they said, we'll take you up on that. Because as a child, this was a don't throw me in the briar patch moment, because as a child, I remembered taking sips of apple cider vinegar with my brother. And I knew that while it sounded gross, I could handle it. And so I took it, I opened the top, we started the timer, I took a big chug, and immediately there was a projectile. Yep, I lost $100 and I threw up in the kitchen.
At least you probably threw up on them.
That's true, it wasn't carpeted, yeah. Thank you for finding the silver lining there. That is a glass half full woman over there. Wow. I wish I had your sunny disposition. So So one more, I'll just tell one more story because it was sort of related to the origin of Gishwiz. How many of you have done Gishwiz or know about it? Yes. So at the University of Chicago, we had this one, University of Chicago, when we went there, it was not a fun place. You had to invent your own fun. You had to play King of the Mattress Pile or something like that, or make your roommate puke or whatever. We had to invent our own fun because it was really, we had a t-shirt. It was like the, you know, basically like the school t-shirt that everybody wore around. It said, University of Chicago, where fun comes to die. And but we had this one long weekend every year called Scav, which was a scavenger hunt. And we all got so into it. It was just so much fun. It was the one bright spot on the calendar. And Vicky, who is now my wife, who was my girlfriend at the time, was on a different team than me. She was in a different dorm, so she was on a different team. And she came, we were doing scav, and she came to me. I was one of the few people that had a car. I had this old Volvo sedan. And she said, can I borrow your car? I found three live sheep in Wisconsin. And the item was to bring three live sheep. That was just one of the items in scav. You had to show up with three live sheep, which is hard on the south side of Chicago. And I said, no. A, you're on a different team, and B, I have like fabric seats. I have cloth upholstery in my sedan. You're not bringing three sheep in my car. And then I went to sleep, and then she took my keys and went to Wisconsin without a sheep. And they didn't even bother to put down newspaper or anything like that. And there was a waiting period, like the sheep were actually had to just hang out with the windows cracked in the Volvo for about 4 hours. And they were just like pawing their own feces into the fabric and eating the seats. that same year, Vicky, one of the items was you had to bring a live Hooters waitress.
As opposed to a dead meat?
And
not
know,
a dead one?
I don't know if you guys can try this, but they're very difficult to capture. And so she took matters into her own hands and she just went to Hooters. She's well endowed and she's like, can I get an application? And she got a job at Hooters just so that she could show up in the uniform. Anyway, that was sort of the beginning of Gishwiz. I've tried to incorporate Hooters waitresses in a few Gishwizes since then. I think we had one of the items was take a photo of a Hooters waitress reading the feminine mystique. And some of those photos are actually awesome. I agree. 100%. Okay, Eric, have I covered enough, or is there more? That was inspired by the ass grabbing tangent, so you got there.
Ass grabbing, all right. Of sheep.
Does anybody have any like questions they want to ask Eric, or?
Where do we start? Plenty.
Where are his photos?
Embarrassing pictures.
Embarrassing photos.
But you repeat yourself.
Eric, do you have any embarrassing photos? He said, in case you missed that, he said they're all up here. Yeah. What was it? Okay. Do you want to field that one? Do you want to come up here?
Yeah.
only because I don't want to keep shouting over at you. What was it like with Misha?
Do you remember?
It was always an adventure. You didn't know what was coming next because you had these inspired challenges, inspired adventures, and it was always game for anything. Usually when the rest of us weren't. But there was always a bit of magic to it because it always seemed to turn out. I don't know how
You were talking earlier about that. I was doing woodworking.
Like,
yeah. So Misha was. So Misha will tackle anything, whether he knows how to do it or not. But his learning curve is crazy. So he started woodworking. And I actually have this. This is a treasured item in my home. I have this little half-length wooden cooking spoon that Misha carved and sanded for me. I think you were driving from Boston to Chicago, and you were sanding the spoon in your lap. That isn't the most ADD thing you've ever heard. I literally was like, well, it's an 11-hour drive. I'm not going to waste the time, so I'll do a little whittling on the drive. But he quickly graduated from half-sized cooking spoons to, he said, well, if I can make a spoon, I can make a queen-sized bed. So what I remember about Misha moving into this apartment is all the lumber he hauled in. And hand tools. I don't think you had any electric tools. It's all chisels and sandpaper. And where are you going to put all this stuff? And he just piled it. He, of course, got the smallest room in the apartment because he came last. So he stuck in the smallest room. He had all his lumber in there and no bed until he made it. I don't know how many weeks or months.
I can't imagine how annoying that must have been. Like somebody like pounding away, building something that they don't need to be. It's like one thing if it's like, it's maintenance, we need it done. It's not necessary at all. We have a perfectly good pile of festering mattresses right over here. I just wanted some space between me and the mattresses.
Yeah, so the beautiful thing is, once he was able to complete this, and it's truly a beautiful, do you still have it?
Uh-huh.
This beautiful handmade bed, beautiful headboard and footboard, and then of course the crowning moment is when you got to put one of those mattresses on.
That's good. All right, thanks. That reminds me of one more story, and then I'm not going to tell any more stories, I promise.
No.
So, I just have to tell this though. It was so bizarre. So, my wife's mother gave her a promise ring. I'll just take it back. What's that? In high school, my girlfriend at the time, wife now, wanted to come over to my house. I was a day student, she was a boarding student. And so, she asked her mom if she could go spend the night on the weekend at her friend Misha's house. And her mom was like, sure, that sounds harmless. And then later her mom found out that Misha was me and that I wasn't a girl, and she was really pissed. And so she gave, she's a church-going woman, and she gave Vicky a promise ring. The promise was, it was a nice ring with like a valuable diamond in it. And Vicky was like, sure, I'll take that. And the promise was not to have sex before you're married. And I'm not going to say promises were broken, but I will tell you that I gifted Vicky this bed. And we were together moving, I guess we ended up moving rooms at one point in the apartment. And we were moving from one room to another, disassembled the bed, and we were carrying the headboard. And her hand got wedged between the frame of the bed and the door frame of our new bedroom. This was like our first moving in together moment. And it squeaked, broke the ring. Luckily, we could salvage the gold and the diamond from it and sell it, so. You have a question, comment, criticism. Yes. Boy, do I.
First, Misha Collins, I want to thank you for all the good you've done to those who are in need.
Oh, well, thank you. I've done lots of bad things to people, too, as well. Thank you for saying that.
And second of all, where do you come up with all the different voices for Castiel? where is your awesome?
Where do I come up with the different voices for Castiel?
Oh, you're right.
I think a lot of times it comes from, what is that? My ass. We just did a, so an episode next week is going to be airing the Scooby Natural Crossover. Supernatural has, for several years now, as I think some of you are aware, been snubbed at the Oscars. We haven't gotten a single Oscar nomination.
Oscar.
It's kind of ridiculous at this point. It's very political. But we were in the Kodak Theater on Tuesday, this past Tuesday, which is where they have the, that's where they host the Oscars, and we were watching the premiere. They did a screening of Scooby Natural on the screen in the theater that the Oscars happen at. And then we got up on stage and answered questions there. And it was so cool. It was so, so, so cool. But one of the questions, we got a similar question. Not saying that you're derivative. but we got a similar question, and Bob Singer and Andrew Dabb, sorry, I'm mixing up showrunners, that's not good. Can you delete that portion from the online stream?
How much money you get?
Bob and Andrew were there, and they were commenting on the voice that I had done earlier this season for Empty Cats. And thank you. And they said that when they got the footage back from that shoot, they had run into one another's offices and said, "What the hell is he doing?" It took them by surprise, and they did not like it. I don't know why I did it, but I just realized I have another opportunity coming up to make up another weird voice next week, so I'm gonna go for it. Thank you for reminding me that I have to do that. Hi.
Hi, Misha. So I was wondering what it is that you first think of when you wake up, and when
in the most family-friendly way.
I need an adult.
My days are very much bookended, typically, my typical days, because I have small children. And we have a family ritual that is totally out of control, which is that we put the children to sleep in their bed, and then right around when we're, you know, going to sleep ourselves, the kids come into our bed. And they're usually crying or fidgeting in some way. They always need whatever the opposite arrangement that we have with the blanket is. So if I'm cold, they're hot, kicking it off. And if I'm hot, they're cold and they're pulling it up. They like to snuggle, but only when they're snoring. Like, if they're congested, they want to be as close to your ear as possible. But if they're feeling, like, healthy and they're in good spirits, then they just go perpendicular and kick. So, typically, I go to sleep thinking, try to cherish this. It's not going to last forever. You know, eventually they're not even going to want to hang out with you. If this is, you know, frankly, this is the best you can get right now, so take it. You'll be able to sleep in a few years. And then in the morning, my son wakes up. He's really into numbers. He loves numbers, and he loves, like, thinking, he thinks about the time a lot for some reason. We have this little clock, which I always turn away from the bed so he can't see what time it is, because he'll get up, he'll look at the clock, and then he'll announce, as if the house is on fire, what time it is. He'll be like, Dad, it's 6:10! Get up! And And so, you know, they're adorable and they're little children. And so I say, get out of my room. Go into your own room. Leave us alone. Shut the door. You should not be awake right now. So I almost invariably wake up angry. And not the person that I want to be at all. I actually usually fall asleep when I'm putting them, I fall asleep twice. So I fall asleep when I'm putting them to sleep, and then I wake up 15 minutes later, refreshed, and then I go into what's basically a night of hell after that. But that, you know, that falling asleep moment can be very sweet too. I think generally, like when they're going to sleep, we have like a nice, connected, sweet moment. And then when they're waking up, I'm like a fucking maniac. I've told this story before, but I'm gonna tell it again. So Mason, we were all snuggled. They like to like go one kid in each armpit when we're reading a book and we lie down together. And Mason said, I said, I want you guys to stay my little, I want you guys to stay my little kid forever now. Mason said, no, Daddy, I'm gonna grow up. And I said, no, Mason, I want you to stay my little kid forever. No, 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 no. He said, no, I'm gonna grow up. And I said, no, I want you to stay my little kid forever. No, no, no. He said, no, I'm gonna grow up, and then I'm gonna get old, and I'm gonna die. Stop, huh?
I was like, yeah, we have a plan there.
Yes.
Hi, Misha. So,
hi.
I want to start off by saying I kind of hate you.
Thank you.
Me too.
Stay with me. Mm-hmm.
Don't we all?
This year, I decided, you know, maybe I want to be a better person.
What?
Why?
Positivity in the
world. No, 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 no.
Awful,
no.
Right?
Yes.
Exhausting.
Give it up.
So I've been trying to do like a random act of kindness each day, and I was wondering were any organizations or items or things that you think are maybe underrepresented or underhelped to give me ideas for the next few months.
I'll give you an idea. One idea. Not multiple ideas, because I like to keep my ideas to myself.
Selfish.
But yeah, selfish. Yeah. I mean, typically I also charge for my ideas, so that makes this a little weird. Like, if I give you a free idea, then I have to give other people free ideas, and pretty soon the whole business model falls apart. So, it's charity work?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, whatever. So, we did this, we've done similar things to this in Gishwas a few times, but it's basically like, notice a homeless person as an act of kindness. And it's kind of remarkable when you give yourself such a small, simple directive, how much can come of that. You know, you can actually, I think that, you know, we have this tip, or at least I have for a long time, have this sort of typical knee-jerk response. Like, I see somebody homeless, maybe has a cup out asking for money, and I get like tight about that interaction. Like, maybe I'll put some money in the cup, but I don't want any more than that. You know, I don't want to engage. And so we sort of started this experiment with Gishwas and found a lot of people, and myself included, having really lovely exchanges with people if you open yourself up to that possibility. And you know, so you don't. It doesn't have to be about giving money or Kennedy.
I heard your story about how someone gave you a gift card, so I actually keep a bunch of gift cards in my wallet, so when I drive by for like food and Target
awesome.
And stuff.
And you know, even that like simple thing, I think it means the world to people. Like I shared that story, but you know, when we were kids, we didn't have a lot of money, and the kindness of strangers went a long way for us. But I did this thing with Mason. I think it was just Mason. I took her down. There's like a in Bellingham where we live up north. We went to this little park where a lot of homeless people hang out, and we just went into the park and we said, hey, anybody need anything in particular? We're going to make a run to the Target and get stuff. And we basically like took down a list of items that people needed. Like somebody needed a tent, somebody needed a sleeping bag, somebody wanted a month bus pass, somebody wanted a haircut. And so we just went to the little mall, we got all of those things, we brought them back, and we had really lovely conversations with this small cluster of people where they were all telling us like how they got into this situation, you know, why they're finding themselves homeless right now, and what would be helpful for them, you know, getting out of that situation. Anyway, if, I don't know, I think that a big part, I talk too much, I know that. But I think one of the best things about charity work is when you actually allow yourself to empathetically understand the people that you're trying to, quote unquote, help. Because a lot of times it ends up helping us just as much or more than it does the people that we're ostensibly trying to benefit.
Okay, thank you.
Hi.
Hi. My name's Debbie.
Hi, Debbie.
Hi. So if Supernatural was a reality show, would you still be...
Isn't it?
Well, kind of, sort of. But I mean, like, we're like the Kardashians.
Oh, good God.
Oh, I see. You mean really scary.
Would you still be Cass, or would you prefer to do a different character?
But, and pardon my French, what the fuck does that have to do with the reality show part of it? Like, if it's a reality show,
yes.
Would
you be content portraying the character Cassie?
Got it.
Would you be Cass in real life?
Fundamental misunderstanding. A reality show doesn't have fictitious characters in it.
I'm
just
trying
myself
life.
In a bit of a bind here, because if it was a reality show, I don't think I would be Cass. Are you saying a reality show about Cass, Sam, Dean, and
yes.
company?
Okay. Like it's
if they were real people,
yes.
and we were just following them around
right.
In a roommate situation,
right.
With like weird, you know, erotic injury between some of the characters.
Probably
want to
keep it real.
You want a PG reality show?
No,
that's your choice. Your choice. You're gonna lose a lot of viewers, but you're obviously not a network executive. So I can, but I have the choice to not be Cass in this scenario. Who would play Cass? Who would you cast as Cass?
Well,
Alex.
Whoever felt that they could play that role the best, because
okay.
that's how they are.
I see.
Alex Calvin.
So Alex Calvin. has anyone else noticed a likeness?
Yeah. Also. He owes me a beer for that.
Eric, just to fill you in, there's a new character on the show this year who is, he's a Nephilim, which you're familiar with, of course, that term. And an angel-human hybrid. And
okay.
he looks exactly like I looked in college. And it's quite uncanny. It's so much so that he and I have tried to like trace things back. Like, was I in the same place as his biological mother at some point 25 years ago? It's uncanny. Anyway, yeah, I would play Cass because Cass is the best.
Yeah. I just want to tell you I love you a lot.
Thank
and
you.
I love Cass, so thank you so
oh,
much
good.
For bringing
good.
Him into the world.
Thank you.
I just was, I saw that
I
you were downtown
right
today, doing, I'm at the march,
mm-hmm.
and I just wanted to talk about how that went, and what your views and opinions are on it, and why you march today.
My views and opinions are things, I'm fairly open with them.
Mm-hmm.
I share them
on the internet. I'm very, very pro-Trump.
Yeah, we can tell. Should have done a spit take right there.
MAGA guys.
You're dead to me.
For me, the main reason that I have been, you know, really jumping on the March for Our Lives bandwagon is that I love seeing young people getting politically engaged. This rally was, you know, most of the speaking time up on stage at the pre-rally before the march was given to high school students, and I think that's awesome. It gives me hope for the future, which is something that I've been lacking lately. So I really love, I love seeing that there is this upcoming generation of prospective voters who have the power to turn the tide. And I want to throw my support 100% behind them, because I see a lack of apathy in the 16 to 21 year old group right now. That cohort seems to care for some reason, and I think that's really inspiring, and I love it. So yeah, I worked a little bit on the Doug Jones campaign in Alabama. There was a Senate campaign against Roy Moore, who was like accused of being a serial pedophile or whatever. And one of the things that I was trying to help with was getting young voters in Alabama out. And it was remarkable to learn in communicating with the campaign that when pollsters ask, when you hear like poll numbers, it's about likely voters. They don't count that group. Young people don't vote typically, so they're not considered likely voters. And that means that if young people start voting, they could actually take the reins of the political process, because they're totally underrepresented. And if they, as a group, got engaged, it would change everything, I think. So anyway, that's why I was my job.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you for coming.
That's what she said.
I always wondered how you guys deal with the loss of your anonymity out there. I mean, you're phenomenal actors, and now everybody recognizes you. And I'm sure most of your life you didn't have to deal with that. So.
No, I've always been well recognized. because people thought I looked like Alex Calvert. They missed me. You know, we are, I mean, the show has been on, I'm not sure if you're aware, but it's been on for some time. And for the first long time, for the first maybe 7 years that I was on the show, I mean, I would get recognized, but it would be like once a day or something like that when I was out and about. It wasn't a big deal. And it's still, by the way, it's more now because people watch it on Netflix, and you know, it's just been around for so long that it's, you know, a lot of people just come across it at some point. But I'm still basically just like, you know, having a normal life most of the time. And it's great. Because the show, you know, has, I mean, when we're on the air on the CW, I think we get like 1 million viewers or something like that. You know, there are shows that have 15 million viewers. So we're this like little cult niche.
Yeah, but we're passionate.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. Hold on. So we go about our lives, we have normal lives, and then we get to come to a fan convention where there's a concentration of the most passionate fans, and for a few hours we get to feel like we're important celebrities. We get a very healthy boost to our egos.
And then
people come up and say things like, I love you, and you're like, yeah, of course you do. And then you go home and you get peed on by your trash. I think it's a perfect balance on this show. It's just right. Thank you.
So last year
in May at KidCon, Jared screwed up.
Typical.
In revealing that you had already done some of your
this
year, therefore revealing that you would be coming back and that cast would be coming back despite the fact that you had just been killed off the night before. So my question, sorry to bring up bad memories.
Good memories.
That idiot. If Jared had screwed up, was it the plan to keep Cass's reveal coming back for as long, a secret as long as possible, or was Andrew Dabb planning on making a statement like a week later saying, you know,
basically,
Lucifer's
if Jared
dad
had fucked up, what would
killing
have
him? Yeah, just kidding, he's coming back, so calm that down.
I think we would have tried to milk it for a little longer.
So
you know? Well, I think a lot of people, in fairness, I think a lot of people, you know, the show has been around for a long time. A lot of people have grown up actually watching the show now. It's 13 years. I just had a photo with a woman who named her son Castiel, and he's now 8. That's so crazy. So, of course, you know, people watch the show for a long time. They get to know and love the characters. Some people particularly identify with Castiel and really love that character in particular.
Yes.
And so when the character dies, a lot of fans actually have a real experience of mourning, you know? And we want to drag that out as long as possible. You know, I mean, we want to milk that suffering as much as possible.
So we have Jared to thank for fucking up.
I think that's pretty much a go-to. We can pretty much count on that.
Yeah. He was so hungover. Okay.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Well, how are you? Thanks for asking.
I'm here. So I know that you came here on a road trip with Ruth and Richard, and I was just wondering if you could expand on that, like how it went, and if you had any other funny stories that like happened.
Well, that's a yes. How much cocaine did that car go through?
All right, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to tell you something that I should not tell you. We learned, Richard Spade and I learned that Ruth is a terrible judge of character.
She think you're good people.
We had just been shooting, and it was all of us and Mark Pellegrino and the boys. We were all on set together, and Ruth got in the car and she said, "Isn't Mark Pellegrino just the cutest?" Oh. I said, "No, he's not. That's the absolute wrong word to describe him. He's a lot of things. I like Mark, but he's not." Huge. He's not a cutesy pie. He's got a black belt in jiu-jitsu. He's definitely the scariest dude on set. We did a fight scene in the cage with Mark Pellegrino where it was me, Jared, and Jensen all trying to, you know, fight him. And it was clear that if we had actually been in combat, he would have destroyed all three of us. that was shocking. We actually mocked Ruth for that for a very long time. And enjoyed it quite a bit. There are other things that happened on that road trip. Things that there are children in the audience, so I can't tell you about. That photo, let me just, you know, spoiler alert, was just the tip of the iceberg, so to speak. Not true. Just kidding. Or am I? Okay.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Well, suffice to say, we made the driver sign an NDA. Hi.
Hi. Had you known back when you auditioned how much Jared and Jensen would prank you, torment you, fondle you, and do the flirty look to break you, would you still have signed up for the role, or would you have saved yourself the trouble?
We were shooting a scene last night before our road trip started, and in my close-up, shock and surprise, Jared and Jensen were standing on either side of the camera. The camera was pointed at me, and right as I was approaching the camera with my dramatic walk-up,
walking up, delivering a line, which, by the way, in the whole scene, I only had one of. Walking up, delivering my line, and just as I started moving, they would pass a prop in front of the lens.
Would this prop be well endowed?
We had to do it so many times. And Dave, our dolly grip, the guy that pushes the apparatus and the cameras on, said, "Don't they want to go home too?" It was the last shot of the night. And everybody, the entire crew, would be able to go home for the weekend if they would stop fucking around. And yet, they get such pleasure out of that, that they didn't care that they were holding up their own weekend. And rather than when I finally, they would pass the prop, and then they'd start giggling, and in that moment, when they were giggling, and so, you know, what is that, they were self-satisfied or whatever. In that moment before they figured out what the next thing they were going to pass would be, I just tried to like very quickly walk up and say my line, like in the window, I caught a window, and I got it out. And the director, Phil, instead of yelling cut, he said, "Okay, we can finally go home." they do wear us down. Yeah, there have been a few times. Nina she's directed a few episodes with us, and she's just lovely. She's kicked them both off set, and had me just do my stuff without them. And that's actually, of course, so much easier. And recently, this fall, we were shooting a scene with Alex, and some of the ribbing and fondling, et cetera, that you mentioned, has been mercifully transposed onto Alex. And so I think perhaps I was taking a bit of perverse glee in that myself. Yeah. Perhaps I was joining in as well.
It's like Lord of the Flies.
And then Nina said, "All right, that's it. I want you guys out of here." And I was like, "Finally, Alex and I are going to be able to do this scene like grown-ups." And she said,
like,
"Misha,
no,
you
too."
And it was like a knife in my heart.
You've made it.
I had become the enemy.
So would you have taken it? You never said yes or no, whether you'd still take the role.
Well, some of the fondling has been nice. Yes.
Hello, Misha. How are you?
How are you? Love your wardrobe today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for wearing it. Yeah.
So my question for you is, now that it's been established that there's multiple universes out there, and it could be possible for really anyone to show up in any universe, who knows how many doors there are, what do you think would happen if cast were to meet either an alternate Meg meat suit, where it's like Rachel Miner, or if you were to meet Meg, like the demonic spirit, those things, so what do you think that encounter would be?
Well, that would be fascinating. Only cast from our universe, or should I say the supernatural universe, would know Meg, presumably. She wouldn't know him. So she probably wouldn't immediately be as flirtatious as she had been in the past. But I think that Cass has always had a soft spot for, not always, but he's developed a soft spot for Meg, and I think he probably misses her. So I think that he would try to rekindle something. It's a great idea. Why didn't you ask the writers that question earlier? That would have been awesome. Good question. Thanks. Yep. Hi.
Hi, Misha. My name is Katrina. First off.
You're what?
Gorgeous.
You're what?
First off.
What did you say?
My name is Katrina.
Hi, Katrina.
And I want to start off with saying that you're gorgeous.
Oh, well, see, this is what I was talking about earlier. This is like the ego boost. It's lovely. Thank you very much for saying that. That's very charitable of you.
Imagine that. I would like you to choose which of the questions I'd like to ask.
Okay.
Either a serious one about the new potentials for the alternate realities,
yep,
or a question about doggies.
A serious question, obviously.
Doki!
They're both very serious.
Okay.
Because your opinion matters.
Yep.
So, a serious question about the alternate reality then.
Yep.
Who do you think would be more powerful? Jack, as he is amazing, or baby Meg Steele?
Oh.
Baby Meg Steele?
Yes.
Oh,
potentially
I see.
An alternate universe, Meg
well,
Castiel.
You know what? I actually think that there's a lot of potential in the baby Meg Steel thing. Interesting idea. That's another interesting story point. And we could even film the conception.
Can I pay to not?
That's
no.
A great idea.
Please no.
How much would we pay
Please
for
no.
that not to happen?
I was in a movie years ago, a very independent, very, very
Debbie
independent
does
movie
that.
Where me and the lead actress had a bunch of make-out scenes. We would make out. And her acting teacher, this is a sidebar or a tangent, as it's known in the business. Her acting teacher was like, well, in order to get comfortable with this, you guys should probably just go make out a bit. And I was like, oh, all right, well, that's great. So we did. We went over to her house. She lit a fire in the fireplace, and we just made out on the carpet for a few hours. And then I went home, and I was like, yeah, it was just rehearsing. It was great. I just made out for a few hours. Acting teacher said we had to. It was really great. You don't really get to do that kind of work that often, so it's nice. It's good work when you can get it.
Going method.
So that's a tangent. But I was going to answer your question seriously. Here's the thing. So yes, admittedly.
The puppy's question.
What's the character's name?
Meg
Steele.
Which one?
Meg Steele. All right, we have Meg Steele, which would be a mashup of an angel and a demon.
Yes.
Which is something that I don't know we've seen before.
Yes, we have.
That's like dark matter and light
just
matter meeting. Just like maybe it would create
just
a black
demon,
hole.
Demon
it would
and
be
angel.
A big
angel.
Demon.
Oh, angel.
And then, you know, on the other side, you got like, it's like, yeah, I mean, we have the devil as the father, so we've got, you know, powerful Nephilim, but I think that the demon angel mashup could be good. So, yeah, I like your thinking.
Thank you.
Thank you for planting that seed, so to speak.
Hi. So my question is, what are your thoughts about Destiel, and what's your best memory you have with Dean?
My thoughts on Destiel, oh God, I mean, I could go on and on and on. You know, it's funny, I'll tell you this, I'll tell you my perspective on the conversation about Destiel, which has been a very interesting journey. When I first got on the show, I broached the topic because I had Googled and discovered completely unaware, nobody told me about this stuff, but I was just like, I got on the show and I was basically, I think I was Googling to see if the fans liked me, to see if I was gonna get killed off. I was like, are they gonna kill me? Do they like me? And I Googled around and I found out that what they really liked is me, my character giving Dean's character a blowjob. I didn't even know what fan fiction was. I've never heard of slash fiction. And so I found this like essay that somebody had written, and it was like, wait, but this doesn't seem like it's from a script. And then it was like all of a sudden, like, wait, I definitely didn't see any script. Bean unbuckling Cass's pants. So anyway, I broached it at a convention, and when I did, there was like this, like this gasp of horror, like, oh my God, my dad just found my porn. And everyone was horrified. And then there was a period where there was like this little bit like, maybe we can talk about it, maybe we can't, and then it was a band. Nobody's allowed to bring that up anymore at the conventions, and if you do,
you die.
Cut off.
It's all right, we're gonna kill her later.
And then I think now people just don't, somehow it feels like people don't really care anymore. It's like, it's fine, we can talk about that. I know that you've seen my porn, and it's fine and whatever. So I think that that's been kind of an interesting arc to watch, like the interplay of how either collectively ashamed or appalled everyone is over this has sort of dissipated into just like, no, whatever, everybody's a pervert. by the way, I'm going to get in trouble for using that term because
yeah, it is true.
I always get in trouble from somebody when I talk about this at all. But I also think that, like, you know, Jensen and I have had conversations about it. We've all had conversations about it. And it's something that
action replay.
I think we all kind of feel like, great, you know, good on you. Jensen and I don't write a ton of SEO. but that's just because we live it all the time.
You're a bad person.
Gishbox Casino is over. The shop is being closed. From what I understand, some of the Gishbox are being severely punished for orders that have been messed up severely. How soon will we hear if there's going to be a continuance of Gish in some way, shape, or form?
I'm not telling you anything.
But yes.
What?
Our team.
What about your teams? You're welcome to keep your team. You're absolutely welcome to do a hunt with your team. That was definitely a cry for help. There's some stuff that might come down the pipe, might not. I'll leave you in suspense. Why? Would you like it to continue?
Yes!
Okay. Well, as you know, I like to see people suffer, so maybe we will end it.
We're suffering.
We have something coming down the pipe, but I'm not going to tell you what it is.
Awesome. Thank
yeah,
you.
Thanks.
Is it herpes? Genital.
So I was wondering if there's an aspect of Cass's personality or life experiences that you personally identify with, and if so, why?
Teleportation.
I guess,
references.
You know what, I mean, I've answered this question in one way many
constantly
times,
being constipated.
Which is that I actually think that the writers adapted the character once I started playing Cass. You know, there was the first version of that character was very militant and like just a badass fighting soldier who was there to get shit done, and he was super powerful. And very quickly that character morphed into a socially awkward dweeb who always had his powers broken in some way or another. And I definitely feel that the writers adapted Cass to my personality. But I also am, I see Cass as like a watchful person and also as an introvert. He doesn't relish a lot of gregarious social interaction. I think given the opportunity, Cass would just sort of sit alone and be quiet. And that is me as well. I'm a total introvert, and that's not a joke. Like, you guys see me get up here and be boisterous, and I like come to a convention, and I can, you know, glad hand with the best of them. But the truth is, like, if you give me a 12-hour window,
I'm not calling anybody, I'm not making lunch plans, I'm gonna go, you know, into my office and read and write and be by myself, and that's, you know, that's what I want. I'm definitely an introvert, so I think that Cass and I kind of share that. And
Thank you.
And also, I can heal people just by touching them.
Also, you can make them poop, not poop for a week.
Yes, this could turn into like a revival healing session. Would you guys be up for that?
Sure.
Yeah, totally.
Praise Jesus.
So, is there another one last question? You guys want to do one more question?
Sure, do one more question.
Hi. How did it go, by the way, backstage?
That's it. That's the last question. He was burned. Great. It went fine. Now the show's over.
Well, that was stupid.
Sorry, I used up the last question on these assholes. Okay, go ahead. Take one extra last one.
You put on your jacket to match me?
Yeah.
Is this still related to the bug grabbing stuff?
It's all about the bug grabbing.
Okay, got it. All right. You look sharp. Thanks, man. You look sharp.
Thanks. That was cold.
All right, so we'll do, that was actually the penultimate question. This will be the last question.
No one says
penultimate.
Well,
you're doing really good at trying to torment a fan here.
I'm sorry about that. Yeah.
So,
I did want to ask you one more. Okay. you guys doing the concert tonight?
Yeah. Yeah. It's happening. Saturday night special.
Is it going to be great? Is it going to be excellent?
It's going to be special.
Yeah. It's going to be special. This one's going to be special. I know we call them all the Saturday Night Special.
We don't mean this one's going to be
just
special.
Just what we mean, yeah. All right.
It's going to be great.
I'll try to come see the show.
It's a good segue, because Billy and I wanted to do this whole musical thing with you right now. We've been doing, I don't know if you know, there's a social media craze sweeping the nation. It's called Dick Chat. And right now, too. And so, we've been doing, anybody been following Dick Chat? We've been doing the Breaking the Law series, where we play the riff from the Judas Priest song, play the riff there. And the person has to scream, breaking the law, breaking the law.
Okay.
So that's what we're going to do right now. Let me tee this up. And audience, you're next, so get ready. So this will be Mr. Collins' version. Billy, go. I'm just gonna keep filming around.
Hi. What's your question? I'm sorry. I asked them not to send them out on stage if they came in.
Well, when I was watching the promo for the Scooby Natural episode, I noticed one little itsy bitsy problem with Cass's outfit in the animated version. It's striped. And I know that the animation started like right when season 12
wrapped. I didn't even pick up on that. Oh my god, that's such a good observation.
Blows your mind!
Wow. Oh my god, so, alright, so last year, Castiel had a striped tie. It was last March, I believe, or maybe April, that we went in to record the voiceover for Scooby Natural, which airs next week. So it takes a full year for them to make the animation. And at the time, they were basing the look of the Castiel that they put into the Scooby Natural universe on the look that Castiel had at that time, which was a striped tie. You are so astutely pointing out that that is no longer the look. So of course, anybody watching this episode will see me in my up-to-date Cass wardrobe. With a solid blue tie, getting sucked into the television, and then suddenly in the animated version of that character, it's gonna be a striped tie, and so the whole thing is gonna be unbelievable. Yeah, I mean, nobody completely unable to suspect your identity at all.
In some weird way, you're breaking the law, breaking the law.
Oh man, that's too bad. Well, anyway, you can have your friends tell you about it if they watch it, but I wouldn't bother watching because it's going to be ruined for you now.
It's the most bizarre thing I've ever seen. It's totally unbelievable.
Wow, that was weird.
It is awesome. It was so. I think it might be the best episode of Supernatural ever.
That's amazing.
It's really so weird, and it's a full. It is a full episode of Scooby Doo embedded within an episode of Supernatural, and
that's so crazy.
What? And it is gory. It's like there's stuff in there that none of the animators and none of the writers and directors on the show thought that they're like, well, we'll try to sneak it past standards and practices, but they're not going to let us do this, and they did. We were in the voiceover studio and doing our looping a year ago for this, and Jensen ad-libbed a line, and it was something like. No fucking way. And everybody laughed. And that's in there. I mean, admittedly, they beat it out, but it's still like, there's an episode of Scooby-Doo where a character is swearing under the airplane.
You better for Shaggy saying, it's pretty awesome.
No fucking way, Scoob.
Ah, that's good. That's a good Shaggy, man.
Wow.
All right, hidden talent.
Bye, you guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time.
It's like if Gladys Knight quit and all you got were the pips. You're gonna get background vocals and music. That's all you're gonna have today. Ha! Ah, oh yeah! Ooh!
Hey!
Show enough! I don't know what's happening next. Oh, I think autographs are happening next. Okay, good. Go do that, and then grab a bite, hydrate, and then come back here tonight for Saturday Night Special.